My name is Matthias Troyer. I'm a distinguished scientist at Microsoft Quantum. And my passion is to trying to solve seemingly intractable problems using a combination of the novel hardware and new algorithms. And that has taken me to quantum when I realized that for some of the problems that I want to solve, I will really need a quantum computer. And there are many more people wanting one because of the near potential of quantum computers to solve problems that are classically intractable. And there's lots of speculation and hype out there of what of the many interesting problems quantum could solve. But we don't really know for sure yet where the biggest advantages will be. And that's where I want to bring some clarity today. So I want to talk about what I call a practical quantum advantage, or quantum practicality for short. And here we're interested in solving a problem that is useful. And by useful, I mean that it's useful either for academics or industry, but it's a problem that somebody really wants to solve. And we want to solve that on a quantum computer faster, better than with any known classical algorithms on the best classical computer. And quantum computing has the potential to do that because there are more than 50 quantum algorithms around with quantum speedup. And they're listed in Stephen Jordan's quantum algorithm zoo. And based on those 50 plus algorithms, there have been many proposals for problems that quantum computers can solve better than a classical one. And it's a maze of the potential applications. And we need to find the promising paths here, the ones that will take us to quantum practicality. And we want to avoid running down the dead ends. So one ingredient for quantum practicality, as I mentioned, is quantum speedup. But we need more than that. And the reason is that quantum speedup refers to asymptotic scaling. So we know that when you have a quantum algorithm with quantum speedup and you look at very large problem sizes, then as the problem size goes to infinity, the quantum computer will always outperform the classical ones. But we also know that for small problem sizes, the classical computer is faster. So it's important to find out where is this crossover size, where is the problem size from which on the quantum computer is better than the classical one, and what is the time to solve a problem of that scale. And we want that crossover time to be hours or days, but not more than a few weeks. Because it is worthless if a quantum computer takes 100 million years just to compute the number 42. It has to happen in weeks. And so to look into that and to find out where quantum computing will be practical, we want to compare a classical computer with a quantum computer. And here I want to be optimistic on the quantum side, and I want to be pessimistic on the classical side. So I want to be totally biased towards the quantum computer, that we're not missing any potential opportunity. And thus we'll compare a single classical chip that we can buy today, something like the high-end GPU from NVIDIA. And I want to compare this classical chip that exists now with a future quantum computer that has fast logical qubits, 10,000 logical qubits with all-to-all connectivity. So really a dream machine for a quantum computer. And comparing those four applications, one of the statements one often hears is that quantum computers will solve the big data problems. But just looking at the classical chip versus the future the quantum computer, we see that the bandwidth of loading data into the quantum computer is at least 10,000 times slower than loading data onto the classical chip. And thus, quantum computers will have an even bigger big data problems because the bandwidth of loading classical data is limited. And thus, they will not really be useful for big data problem or for the database searches in classical databases, where I also have to load the data. They will in general not be the best solution for near data intensive applications, but they will excel for the big compute problems on small data. Thus, let us now focus on computing. And there one often also hears the simplifications that quantum computers are faster than classical ones, since they can explore exponentially many options simultaneously. And we know that simplified a bit, what that really means is we can get a quadratic type speedup with something based on the Grover's algorithm. So let us now see how we can get to the crossover where quantum computers are faster than classical ones with a quadratic Grover speedup. For that, I want to look at the same classical, the same quantum computer, and I want to compare the performance of those devices. And what I see looking at the performance of the classical GPU today, and being optimistic about how many operations they can do on the quantum computer, I find that the classical chip can do about 10 to the 10 times more operations than the future quantum computer. And that is being optimistic on the quantum side, where I ignore all of the overhead for a reversible implementation of the functions. So with that in mind, the quantum computer has quantum speedup. That means it has to, it does, so the quantum computer has quantum speedup, and that means it has to make fewer calls to function. But each call to a function is slower because the fundamental operations will be slower. If we now compare that and want to achieve a crossover where I can see quantum advantage at a time scale of about 2 weeks, then I can ask the question, how complex can this function or the oracle be that I get to this crossover point in that short time? And if I look at that for a function that does floating point operations, then I realize I can only get there when I do not do more than 0.01 operation. Okay, that means I cannot even do a single operation for a crossover time of 2 weeks. If I do even a single operation, the crossover time would be in the months. While for logical operations, I can do about 71 logical operations and get to a crossover time of about 2 weeks. Now, in 71 logical operations, we cannot really do an interesting problem. So what we learn from that is that really quadratic speedup is not enough to achieve quantum practicality in a reasonable time. It will just take much, much longer for the quantum computer to be faster than the classical one. But if we go to quantum algorithm with qubit speedup, it looks much better. With qubit speedup, I can do thousands or millions of operations. With quartic speedup, even more, and with exponential speedup, much more. So the basic takeaway here is that quadratic speedup is not enough. We need a superquadratic speedup. And keep in mind, we were pessimistic on the classical side, using a single of two existing chips, not the biggest machine we can build. and we were optimistic on the quantum side. So this conclusion will really stand. Quadratic speedup is not practical. We need more than quadratic speedup. Thus, let me now look at an example with exponential quantum speedup and think through what will it achieve a practical quantum advantage with exponential quantum speedup in a very simple problem. One of the simplest problems for quantum advantage is the one that is really native to quantum computing, namely simulating quantum systems. And for that, with my collaborators, we looked at what will it take to simulate a quantum spin model on 100 lattice sites for a time that is just beyond what we can do classically. And that will take about 100 qubits, so it's not many qubits. But to propagate that in time to the point where I cannot do it classically, we find out we need about 180,000 quantum gates. Now that is about 1,000 times less than what people previously estimated, but this is really the lower bound now. And with 180,000 quantum gates, while it's not a large number, it is way beyond the capabilities of NISQ machine. To do that accurately, we need qubits with 6/9 fidelity. So even the simplest problem is beyond NISQ machines. And if you then go to fault-tolerant machines to do the quantum error correction in order to do the 180,000 gates reliably, we need to go to at least 40,000 physical qubits for this problem. Or for the more interesting ones, we may need to go to millions of qubits. So with that, we've learned a few lessons that help us find the path through the maze of practical quantum applications. The first thing we learned is quantum computing is for the big compute, small data problems. So anything where the complexity is determined by loading of data is not a good application. We've also learned that to be practical, we need more than quadratic speedup. And if we then apply this view to the maze, then we find that the path goes really to problems like chemistry, material science, getting new catalysts, better batteries, and so on, and solving problems where chemistry can help. This is really a promising direction. While the big data problems, or protein folding problems, and stock market prediction, and weather prediction, those problems that rely on big data or have a quadratic speedup only, they are not on the path to success for practicality. And so with a few simple guidelines, one can shed light on to when and where quantum computers this will be practical. They're useful for the small data, big compute problems with algorithms that have more than quadratic speedup. Even for the simple problems, we'll need fault-tolerant quantum computers starting at 100,000 to millions of qubits. And so that is the guideline I have to find out where the practical applications will be. Thank you.